Good evening and welcome to the Georgetown School Committee meeting of Thursday, February 26th, 2015. I will begin the meeting with approval of regular session minutes of February 12th, 2015, and acceptance of warrants 35V15 and 34P15.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Before we speak to our student representative, I would like to ask everyone to please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have Vanessa here this evening.
So recently on last Friday, we had the students on the France trip come back and they had an awesome experience. Oh, they've been showing a lot of their pictures to the classmates and everything. That was actually cool to hear all their stories of what they got to do. Also, we've had the musical finish up in the beginning of February. That was a great hit and we had a good crowd for a lot of the nights. So that was awesome to have.
That's fantastic.
Mm-hmm. And now we're moving on to Drama Festival, which is, we had a dress rehearsal that was open to the public today, but we'll be performing on Saturday at Chelmsford, at Chelmsford High School, and we'll be competing for awards and different, hoping to move on to semis. That's just preliminary, so that will be awesome as well. And we also just had our spring sports signups yesterday. So right now we're on the in-between of the winter sports and spring sports, but those will start up soon. And we also have our chorus and band concerts coming up. Our chorus, high school chorus and chorale concert is 2 weeks from this past Wednesday.
Is it March 11th?
I believe so.
What are you wanting to know?
The chorus concert for the high school.
Okay.
I have that on my calendar, and then when that March date got scheduled. Let me just double check. Yeah, Choral and Chorale,
okay.
7 o'clock.
Yeah. Sounds good.
And did I also hear that the cheerleaders did great in their competition?
Yeah, they just did awesome on this. I think it was this past Sunday. They earned, I think it was first. Yeah.
Yes,
and did they move
excellent.
On to Triton, I think, coming up?
Yeah, I believe so.
Wow, they're doing great.
Yeah.
Well, good for them. Proud to hear that. Okay, so it's going to be a busy spring, I think.
Definitely.
Once the snow is gone. So thank you, Vanessa. Okay, is there anyone here from the public that would like to talk about anything on the agenda? Okay. If we could have Mrs. Nora Cannon and Rusty Ricker come on up.
I asked Nora and Rusty to come, and they weren't able to bring a couple students tonight. It just didn't work out schedule-wise, but they put together a wonderful project, a wonderful partnership, and I wanted them to come and share that with you. I don't know if any of you had a chance to come by the display, but it was really very nice to see, and it's so nice to see the curriculum connections, you know, coming through on a theme that we all care about. So it was, you know, Nora was able to actually teach the same context of her lessons, you know, in terms of the key concepts, but she just used this as a topic. And it really, it was a great work.
Well, thank you. And
thank you.
First, it started with, you should talk about your safety. And again, I apologize for not bringing many visuals. Remembering the library is closed today because the whole exhibit's there. This is a different agenda item. But we invite you to come to the public library.
Yep, to be on display for another little while. I'm not sure how long they're going to be on display. But
At least a week or so.
What we had done was, our efforts on the fire department was we expanded our fire prevention and our fire safety education up into some of the older grades. Traditionally, we've been in with the pre-K, the kindergarten, the first grade, and it kind of stops there. This year, we were able to expand it a little further. We had discussions with Carol and with the principals, and I thank you for that. Yeah. We get into the second grade and the fourth grade at Pembroke, and we've made our way into the middle school through a couple of poster contests with the sixth and the eighth graders. The sixth graders entered into a regional fire safety education themed poster contest. It's Massachusetts and Rhode Island, and what it there are cash prizes for the students as well as recognition dinner, and there's also grant money that becomes available for the fire department if someone from your school district takes it into which a certain level, and I'm not sure what it is. What we did with the eighth graders, when we entered the eighth graders into a national contest put on by the Consumer Product Safety Commission on carbon monoxide awareness, safety and awareness. Wow. And we were very lucky that these, everything just kind of meshed together. The themes and what the kids were concentrating on fits with the health curriculum with the schools through the DOR, and it also with what Mrs. Cannon was able to do, and Mrs. Sirois as well, was able to take their lessons and what the kids were doing, the different grades were doing, and apply the styles of learning in art to the poster contest that they that the kids, the different kids had entered.
And we wrote an article that's going in the newspaper to alert the community, and we hope to continue this curriculum meshing, though maybe next year we can get, I can't speak for other departments, health or, I was thinking science, but I don't know. But you were suggesting that it's written up in the health curriculum.
Yeah, it's all out in the health curriculum. So.
Okay. So it really worked out well, and you were able to come to the school and actually meet with the students, which is so much, give such an impression. They had some information sheets. Yeah?
How recently were you in the fourth grade doing a presentation?
Fire Prevention Week, so October.
Early October.
Second week in October?
Whatever you did was very effective, because my daughter had a writing assignment up, and I read it. And it's all about a fire in the kitchen, and it's all this dialogue about how they had to crawl on the floor.
Stay low.
That's actually great to hear. It's great to hear feedback. We did what the second grade was. We had the second graders all did a home fire escape plan contest. I'm kind of taking off on the art project, but we gave out information on home fire escape plans, and we sent them home, and the kids and the parents, the families, had to design it, practice it, and the parents had to sign that they had actually practiced it. And the winning classroom, the classroom that returned the most, was awarded a pizza party.
Oh, that's cool.
Holloway's at the Black Swan donated pizzas for us, and it was actually Mrs. Brooks's class at Pembroke that returned 100% of their own fire estate plans. So I think early December, everything finally came together. They were actually able to have pizza with the kids that day. But it was Fire Prevention Week in October that we were in with the second and fourth graders.
Well, clearly you're doing something
that's
right.
That's good. That's good to hear. May they never, ever have to use what
that's
we talked
right,
about.
That's right, exactly.
Except in the stories they write.
There you go.
It is interesting.
It's nice.
So we hope to continue this for next year. Now we've got the ball rolling. And keep your fingers crossed for maybe we'll hear some good news from one of our students. They did all kinds of different artwork, and it went, again, nationally and locally.
The eighth grade...
Right.
The link to the eighth grade, we vote, the people vote for the eighth grade posters. The pictures are online now at the CPSC's website or on the contest website. I know if you go to the fire department's Facebook page, it's linked, and I'm not sure where else.
In the Edline.
Well,
where would you be?
And it's on Edline. Oh, I have it on the morning announcements under middle school, asking the eighth grade. Announcing about the eighth grade. I'll make sure that it's continued for another week or so.
Yeah,
sometimes they might forget to edit on the link. But the links are all there, and it only says the child's first name, and you have to look at the art.
Yeah,
ours are at the bottom of the eighth grade.
Mass.
Okay?
No. it's the first name in Massachusetts. So,
right.
You know, like Chicago politics, vote early, vote often. So
right.
Our kids will do well.
So look for the article in the paper, and if you can make it to the public library, that would be great.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, Rusty, that is great. And actually, while Rusty's here, I mean, the fire department has continued to make a commitment to, you know, working with our students. And actually, I was just reading my email again from Julie DeRoche. Julie can't be here tonight, but she, as Rusty came in and talked to me about this issue of CPR and how could we bring CPR to our staff and students. So Nick Valentini, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Who is a graduate of Georgetown, you know, went to Dartmouth and then went on to Harvard and working with the fire department and wanting to go to medical school. But, you know, they've somehow, Nick's passionate about it. And so they've been working with Julie and Guy Prescott to develop a schedule for next year to train 8th and 10th grade students in CPR. They're looking at developing a schedule for 2 full days for the 10th grade students and teachers, which would be optional, to become CPR certified, and 4 2-hour sessions for training 8th grade students. We're also hoping to schedule 6th grade 45-minute assembly for next year to begin the process of emphasizing CPR awareness for students. But what's so great is Nick is just an amazing young man, and he is so excited and passionate about this.
Very much so.
And he's talk about follow through. He does his research. I mean, it was really very impressive.
Well, he is going to be a doctor.
He is going to be a doctor. But it was amazing. But you know, how exciting is that? I mean, we're talking about the program of studies tonight. I mean, those are all things that, you know, are practical enhancements to the curriculum that are real life skills. But it can't happen without partners like the fire department and the police department, and you know, because you know, I don't think it happens in every town. So I do want to say that I do appreciate that you do, and the chief and everyone in your department, because it does go above and beyond what I think other people.
The relationship that we all have, it makes it that much easier to be able to do it that way.
I know, we've always said that our relationship is good. I mean, Rusty and I go back years with the Horribles Parade.
Yep, with the PTA.
Right, and he's always been such a huge partner with the school, and all the kids know you and respect you, and it, you know, it helps that we have that type of relationship. But we have a great group of firemen, and the police are just wonderful to work with, and I don't think it's like that.
It doesn't
that
happen
every
everywhere. I know it doesn't.
So we appreciate
I talk
that.
To my colleagues, it doesn't. So thank you, Russell.
All right, no,
thank you for
thank
making
you.
The time to come tonight.
No,
as
my
well.
Pleasure.
Yes.
Sorry, we couldn't bring examples, but the library's
well,
kind of locked up.
All right. To the show.
You move on to the next. You're
I'm going to move up to next unless you want to put out a fire or something. Or...
Good, really. Okay. Hopefully there'll be
no
fire at the school.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Not
mine. All right.
Thank you, Rusty. Thank you, Rusty.
Good night.
Okay. Well, this is going to speak for itself if I know the right button to push. Let me see. I think I would either push this or that. It's kind of,
enter maybe?
Is it going to...
Try your mouse.
There you go.
You're going to have to read it. I'm not going to read it for you because we did this for our audience also. All right? So no music, and I'll let you just read along.
So this is something you do annually, right, Nora?
We've been doing this forever. Right. This is a huge part of the whole state of Massachusetts. It is the writing and arts, and here are Silver Key winners. Mm-hmm. We have usually several golds and silvers a year.
Oh, look at that. Our own Mike Murphy.
There you go. This is amazing students. The Scholastic Art Awards are judged against thousands of students. So to make it as far as a silver or honorable mention, it's a pretty high honor. It's not only, it's thousands and thousands of students that they're judged against. So this has been traditionally...
Haley did very well, didn't she?
yes. She's getting her portfolio ready. So these students' artwork, things have changed, and that's as short and sweet as it is. The beginning was basically we as an art department choose the work, and then from there it goes on. And everything is done on CD and pictures now. The old days, which wasn't that many years ago, only 4, we'd physically have to take the work to a spot here in Essex County, then it was brought to Boston, and the work itself was looked at. Now it's all looked at VistaVe computer. The show itself is in Boston, the Silver Keys. Again, we don't even bring them in anymore. Only the gold keys, only the gold keys are seen, and even those they pick. Mm-hmm. And now everything is just a big slideshow, which is kind of nice, but,
but
to me
something.
Personally, it takes
it loses
a little bit.
Something.
So we honor these students at the end of the year at graduation and at the award ceremonies at the end of the year. When they get their certificates, we usually bring it up again and let all their classmates know so it's announced in front of them also. We also make a big to-do at our annual spring art show.
Yeah, do you know a date for that? Because Quinny might want to put that on their calendar.
I don't have it on in front of me right now, but it usually is at the end of April in May, so we have a chance to do it all before our seniors, but we'll get that to you.
Okay, that'd be great, because I think you would enjoy it. You just go and you kind of peruse the art, and they display it all around the foyer and around the hallways right around there. And then they have a whole section of just the seniors. So you get to see, you know, a whole display of, you know, individual seniors and the variety of work that they do.
So all of this work is done in art classes at school?
Absolutely.
Wow.
So some of Haley's work, she does quite a bit on her own on a computer. All the work you saw, for example, maybe Mr. Murphy could add on. I believe she's such a prolific student that she does so much on the computer. All those were mostly done by computer.
Really?
Oh, yeah. And we have the tablets. We wrote the Georgetown Foundation grant, Education Foundation grant. So we received the tablets in the DigVig class. So digital photography, we teach them on the tablets and on the Mac lab. The drawing and sculpture and things like that, or painting, is done in the messy room. And then we have the tech room. yes. And
so there's both. I'm glad to hear that.
Right. Absolutely. Please, you're welcome to come at any time. And visit. Basically, we our studio courses that are in process were product. So they're doing, it's like a studio course where you come in and you're working and learning about art, of course.
That's brilliant. That's lovely. Yeah. Wonderful.
Yeah, our art program is one of our very strongest programs at the high school, along with our theater and music programs. I mean, wouldn't you agree, Vanessa, that you don't even have to be a child who loves art. You know, you come into the program and there's all kinds of variety of electives that you can choose to take. And
yes, as we teach, since you brought it up, I will teach up to, right now I have 6 different classes. I teach a different class every semester, so that we offer the children a lot of variety. We offer printmaking, sculpture. We're asking also to be on a rotating basis, so we're always offering new and different classes for the students. So we as a department, though, we're small. We don't consider ourselves small. Electives are, I'd say we offer 10 to 12 different classes sometimes
that's
a year.
So nice.
So, yeah, keeps us quite busy.
And when they do their art show, they also have a whole video production section.
Right.
So students make their own short films, sort of, I guess. And then the audience has a chance to view them all, and then they get to select the one they like the best, and they have like a little competition. And
they're hilarious.
It is interesting to see the variety.
Well, we have to start sending some in. What we do, it's called a... we call it the film and video show. It's an art plus film festival. So we combine it that night. You look at the art in the halls, and then you come in and watch the film festival. And, it's great to see them on the big screen.
It is. And they're all so different. And I don't know where they come up with their ideas sometimes.
Oh, we wonder that, too.
They are different.
There's a lot of comedy.
About
two-thirds of them.
My son took a video production course, and there's a lot to it. You know, like some of them will do like those claymations.
Right.
Just how many times you have to like take a picture moving it just slightly. You don't really realize that unless you've actually ever seen it or been involved with it. So the kids are really dedicated, I have to say. And it is interesting to see the variety of their work.
Yes, a lot of
really
technical ability. Yes, yes. So we'll keep you updated on that.
Okay.
And thank you for bringing that up.
Yep.
Thank you. Any other, again, I did ask the students, between work and sports, it's really hard to get them here, though I really encourage them. So hopefully, if you come that evening, you might meet some of the students that are represented here. But it is a nice honor that they get for winning a silver, even as a silver or honorable mention.
Mm-hmm.
That's
fabulous. Well, thank you so much.
Yeah. We love doing that. And lastly, I guess I'll introduce is some good news and some bad news. The New York trip was well received by the National Art Honor Society. Unfortunately, when the due date of checks came, I only received 3 checks and a lot of promises. So we really did have to put a limit on that also the hotel in New York wanted their money. Sure. They weren't going to hold the rooms.
And
so,
how many kids did you want? Like 10, right?
We wanted 10. Yeah. 10, a lot more than 10 were interested. But with all the work that went into the planning and so forth, and the permission slips were sent out again. So I just told them it was a learning experience and that we'll try again next year and that we'll move on.
Right.
And
there's plenty to see in Boston,
life. There is plenty to see in Boston, and that's my last point I would like to ask tonight, so you can get on with the rest of your meeting, is that we said we would propose it to you to have a little bit of a change. So March 6th was a day that we had requested off to go to New York, and that I am proposing, along with Mrs. Dodge and the art department, on March 6th, we take them into Boston, give them a kind of a flavor of what we would have done in New York, such as I wrote, not as formal an itinerary, but taking the train in, get history, culture, art galleries. So we're going to keep them just as busy as a day to New York. I lived in Boston for many, many years, so I know my way around quite well. I would like to propose that we could still have that day and take a group of students to Boston, and they would very much like that. It, again, would be Isabella Stewart, the MFA, part of the Freedom Trail, the Old State House, Faneuil Hall, galleries on Newbury Street, ending up in the North End, Old North Church, and then who wants to come? And then we're going to have a cappuccino and get on the train.
So you're not staying overnight?
No. This is just a day trip.
So Peter, you don't have to approve it, Peter.
Yeah, I just wanted to, to let you know. And
I hope that the sidewalks aren't too icy for you.
I know, but, you know, again, what are we going to do?
It's the weather, it's Boston. I think they're going to have just as good of a time.
They will. I really believe they will, and I really want to show them some things they probably hadn't seen. So I can give them a little back scenes of.
So how many kids do you think will attend this one?
This one, we're going to, again, all the kids would like to attend. We aren't going to take classes. We're going to, again, take the portfolio group, the National Art Honor Society, and some of our more serious art students. Not to say that all students aren't serious art students, but it is a privilege. And so that's what we're going to limit it to. It's probably going to only be as high as 16.
And how many chaperones going?
Two, wow. Because you always have to have two in case of something, as you know, would happen.
Yeah.
One could deal with the emergency while the other kept the other. So two is always a good number, so that's why you want your numbers at least 10 or more, because it just makes it work out a little better that way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, so I just wanted to give you an update on that.
That's too bad about New York.
Sure they'll have. We're going to try again for next year.
Sounds good.
So you'll see me again.
Always optimistic.
All right, that's right. Okay.
Thank you very much, Nora.
Okay, and thank you for your time. And I guess I'll just put this down. And
thank you for all that you
do. Put that down, and she'll.
Well, thank you. It's nice to hear that.
All
right. I know you've got a busy night, so I better skedaddle.
Thanks, Nora. Thank you.
Thank you.
All righty. Okay. We have
Peter, I guess, right?
Peter. Yep.
Peter, you want to come on up?
Some very excited school committee members about the program of studies change.
With good reason.
I know.
Good changes.
I read your email before I got my packet, so I couldn't wait to get my packet to see what you were talking about.
Yes. Yeah. Hey, Peter.
Hi.
Hi there.
Okay. So I guess I'll just go through this quickly. The first thing is that we would like to change our grading system. I think the last time I was here, we talked about this a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And this does have the support of the faculty and the school council. I must say that all of these changes were unanimously voted by the school council. So, we would like to institute a D minus to be consistent with the rest of our grading scale. And currently, a failing grade is 64, which would be a D. And if it was consistent with the rest of our grading scale. So we would institute a D minus that is consistent with the other one. So that range would be from 60 to 62.
That would still be passing, the D minus?
Yep. Mm-hmm. And then an F would be a 59. So do you want to go through these one at a time or just do the whole thing?
No, go ahead.
Okay. So the other ones are modifications or additions to the program of studies. The first one is changing honors mythology to honors world literature. This is a senior course. Our senior English curriculum is elective, and it's all college-level semester courses except for one course, honors mythology, which is a full-year course. This will be still a full-year course, and a third of the curriculum will still be mythology, so kids won't be missing out on that. But the thought of the English department is that they would like to expand into world literature because it has been an ongoing need that the department has recognized for a long time, and offer more non-Western literature, which they've been looking to do for a long time. And they believe that the student interest is very strong in this area and that it will attract more students to this course. There's a lot of...
I was really happy to see all of the choices, the literature choices here. I mean, I think it's just excellent, and the things fall apart. I'm very excited that you're going to be reading that. I've got it on. I actually have not read it myself. I kind of delved into it a little bit, and it was gripping. I mean, it was. I want to. It's on my list of books that I intend to buy and get into. But just the title is from The Second Coming by W.B. Yeats, and that is one of my absolute favorite poems of all time. And I just, you know, I feel that I have looked at a lot of curriculums, both in. Well, I mean, choices, course guides, high school course selections in several other public schools, as well as private schools, as well as some of the local private schools, and, you know, compared it to what we have here. And I do think, a greater emphasis on global studies and, international literature is definitely warranted. I mean, it's exactly where I want... You know, I want to see us going. And I was just so happy when I got all of your selections here were just on the same page. I mean, I was actually going to, you know, try to sit down with you and just talk with you about some of my thoughts and ideas for computer science and globalization. But you've got it covered. You've, like, this is where you're going. And, you know, I have a senior son, and we're looking at different colleges, and I've looked at different, programs, majors, minors, and graduate school programs, and a lot of what's here, I'll just go, the global, the world literature, but also the computer studies are going to prepare our students so much, better than they have been in the past. I'm really happy about this for computer science. I mean, all the studies, computer engineering, all the different sciences. I just think all of these courses taken together are going to prepare our students very, very well. And you're filling gaps that I've noticed, and now we're going to have a complete, cutting-edge 21st century program to offer our high school students. And I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. So to go along with unveil what Pam is talking about, we've made a lot of additions to the business department. The business department is probably the curriculum that changes the most as the world changes, and we certainly want to stay current and relevant. So we are adding a bunch of electives to the program. And I should say that many times when I come here with additions to the program of studies, we are also keeping what we have. And so it's giving kids a greater choice. And it doesn't mean that we're going to run everything that's in the program of studies, because it will depend upon what the students want. And that really drives the schedule at the high school. It is really what the kids are interested in and what they want to take outside of the basic standard curriculum. So this doesn't mean that the accountings and the marketings and things like that are going to go away. They're still there. But we want to give kids a chance to really step into 21st century learning with these courses. And I have always wanted to have a computer science track. And the big handicap to that is not being able to have anybody that could teach it. And we really didn't have enough of it to hire somebody. So you're talking about one class, very difficult to find a teacher for that. So fortunately, we do have a teacher now that has some experience in this area and is going to step up and take it on. So we're very excited about it. So we have a computer programming class, and I think the nature of programming is kind of different than it was 10 years ago with, you know, offering a language, a particular language. This computer programming class actually is going to touch upon using Java and C++, the two most popular languages right now. And they have a nice little device called a Raspberry, which is almost like a little tiny computer. And the course is going to really be hands-on, where the kids actually program that device. And it connects to another computer for its power source and stuff like that. That's the good news. And there is no bad news, because you can't wreck the other computer with it if you don't do it right. So there is a CP level and an honors. It's in the same classroom. It's one class together, like we do a lot of times with some of our classes. But there's additional work that you have to do if you want to take it for honors credit. I don't have to tell anybody about how popular apps are now. Mm-hmm. So and we actually did a little sketching of the surface of this in the middle school this year in some of the computer classes, because there's some websites that you can go and do a little of that. So we want to take that a step further in the high school and offer an app course, and I think that's going to be very, very popular.
Yes, kids I've spoken with are excited about this.
Yep. So we're also very excited to get kids involved with helping out with technology in the school. So we want to start a kind of like a little consulting business. So I shouldn't say business, because we're not going to charge. Sorry, Joan. But, maybe another time.
Our own geek squad.
Yeah, we're going to have some kids available with teacher supervision that teachers and students will be able to contact them through email, or actually come in. I think we're going to set them up in the library a couple periods a day, and they'll be able to help people with their problems. So,
computer problems.
Well, that's great. It also teaches them customer service and interaction.
I was going to say, are you going to touch on the customer service aspect of that as well? Yep. Because there is, having been on a helpline for many hours today, wanting to wring the neck of every person I spoke to, there is a little piece of that that probably needs to be learned as well.
Yeah, we'll
especially how to say, I don't know the answer to that. Can I get somebody else for you who does?
Yeah.
Instead of pretending you know the answer.
I think that's a great idea.
But
that's it.
And the next one is Global Perspectives of International Business.
Oh, yes.
That is I'll call it a modern economics course. We have not had much success over the years getting kids to take economics in the school for some reason. We've tried it in two different departments, and actually three, I think. I think at one time even the math department tried to do it. And it just isn't something that the kids, as it was presented, the kids were really too excited about. So this is economics from a global perspective, and we think it's going to be very, very popular. So there are some recommended prerequisites. We're really too small to hold tight to a lot of prerequisites because we just can't schedule it that way, and kids don't have that much play in the schedule. So, but we would like them. We do look at this as more of an advanced business course. So we would like you to take the foundations of the business courses with regard to, you know, marketing, entrepreneurship, and intro to business. And again, we'll offer this as CP and on the honors level. And then in the music department, we want to add another elective.
Yeah, this was exciting.
Yeah, so what we have an elective that we call Found Sound, where kids kind of make their own instruments and stuff like that. And this is kind of like the next step to that. So we want to be able to, most music is made digitally today, and it's, you know, all of the different tracks and the cuts and the things like that, and the dubs are all done on computers today. So we want to give kids a taste of that. And this will be done in the Mac lab, and I think it's going to be very, very popular.
Great.
Sounds like cool.
So that's it.
That's a lot. That's a lot.
That's fantastic. I'm just thinking with this global perspectives, international business. He could speak more about Model UN, but I'm just thinking, and that may have more to do with politics, but you could still use kind of an exciting Model UN group project, group kind of debating type of approach to get people, to get students interested in, you know, how business is done in India and how business is done in South America and what it would take for them to work together and you know, the American interests and you know, I remember in graduate school, I went to graduate school for, I have my MBA, and one of the most exciting things I liked about it was talking to actual business people with experience mm-hmm. from all over the world and hearing how things are done in other places. Mm-hmm. And I think students would love this. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a great way to get them motivated and to understand the principles of economics, sound dry until you understand them.
We talk so often about being in a global economy today, and I'm not sure kids really understand what that is. So this course will definitely bring a better appreciation to that.
Yeah. But the idea of having guest speakers too is a good idea because it does give them a perspective from a person really in the situation. Yeah, that's great, Peter. Thank you.
Yeah, that's exciting.
So, you know, we've talked about just bringing it forward for your first review, but if you're prepared to vote on it, I'm sure Peter would appreciate it because then he can move forward on his process.
Yeah, there is we're waiting to print the program of study so we can begin the scheduling process.
And this is all these courses are all going to be staffed by current staff. We're not adding to our staff, so.
No, it'll be, we will run the most popular courses.
So what happens is you publish to students all courses that are offered, and then the ones that they...
Yeah.
So some students would be notified, sorry, that course isn't going to run in the fall because not enough people signed up. You need to pick something out.
Yep. Yeah, students write down what they want, and then they're alternates.
I see.
So if something, they don't get something that they was their first, or second, or third choice, then there's about three alternates, and then you go into that mode.
Okay. Wow.
But we have a good idea. We have a good idea before I run the schedule. I look at, you know, who wants what, and then we kind of, you know, assign teachers in that way, and so the kids have a good idea what's going to run and what isn't.
And just out of curiosity, so the teachers who are stepping into these new classes, what sort of professional development or is available to them? I mean, we're just assuming, okay, they have the knowledge to teach these courses, but
some of them have the knowledge, and we're actually going to send a teacher out and do some coursework this summer for programming.
Okay, because I'm thinking things in the technology world, they just change so fast. Mm-hmm. So somebody who might have even had a college degree from 5 years ago, you know, they may be a little behind, not on track. And that's the tricky thing with technology, I think anybody has to encounter, is how do you stay ahead of it?
The business department's pretty active in PD. They're always going off to
conferences. The teacher he's gonna have doing this is very into this. I mean, she's bringing a lot of this forward. And he's been working with Wes as well. So, you know, Wes has been.
That was my first thought. I was like, is Wes going to be? Yeah.
Wes is going to be very involved in the
Help desk. When he interviewed, he had said that was a project that he had successfully started in his previous district, and that would be something that he would be particularly interested in seeing if there was interest in Georgetown. So actually, when I saw this, I said, I said to Wes, you're going to get your help desk, right?
So Mary Lyon is really the one that kind of researched this and saw a couple schools that were doing that and was very impressed with it, that she learned at a workshop. And so then she brought the proposal forward. And,
fabulous.
And that's the same group of teachers that, you know, Julie's working with on that innovation grant. Remember that she got that competitive innovation grant?
Right.
They're also the people who really organize the TED Talks seminars. And so they do a great job.
And really, this is their work. They brought this forward to me. And
please share my appreciation with
I did. I forwarded them your note, and they were very excited to hear that.
Yes, I know these folks, and they're wonderful, and they're doing great, great work. So thank you.
So Peter, how many kids, like when they do write down like the courses that they want and then the alternates, how many, like the majority get their picks, or what are your
mostly
thoughts?
They all get their academic stuff, and then when you get to the electives, it's you'll get it before you leave the school. So sometimes when we have like the digital video courses used to be very, very popular, and we could accommodate probably 60 students in that, and 150 would sign up.
So we always
give priority to upperclassmen, and the freshmen and the sophomore that you know they have 3 and 2 years more to get those courses. And pretty much, did you ever not get anything that you wanted?
I only had one time, and it was for academics first, which was fine, and I got to have one of my other choices. But you get to see like the whole course, like all the courses that are given for the year, and then you choose your top favorites, and then you just send it in, and you get the ones that you wanted for the most part.
That's good.
The only ones that are difficult, like you said, are like DigVid or like trying to get chorale and band into your schedule is sometimes
that's hard,
difficult.
Yeah. But I think adding more semester courses helps too.
Yeah.
You know, when you only offer full year courses.
Oh, right.
So I think that these, what Peter's talking about is adding electives that are semester courses.
Yeah,
so a teacher can teach two in a year.
Right.
You know, so that actually is a great strategy to add more options. It's hard
it
in a small school, right? Because
students.
You only have so many sections that you, there'll be so many people in so many sections. But I think in order to increase the opportunities, the way they're structuring it with semester courses is really helping to have more opportunities.
It's
lovely.
It's exciting.
Okay, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the high school program of studies as presented by Principal Peter Lucia.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
I just have one last question.
Sure.
Which is about this D minus grade. How common is that?
Very.
Very. It was odd the way
we talked.
Ours was
we
weird.
Talked about
yeah.
this. Were you not on the? Was it that
the
long
last.
Ago that we talked about it?
I thought we talked about it.
I
the last.
It.
I
was that the last time I was sitting in this chair? We talked about it. I don't think I presented last meeting, but it must have been the one before that.
Yeah, we have talked about that.
Yeah,
it does show. I think I had said to you. I think it was a while ago that I had brought up that other schools I had noticed was more in line.
59,
It, we get we have difficulty with kids that go to other schools for summer school, and they'll get like a 63, and that's a passing grade. The teacher's giving them a passing grade, but that it's not a passing grade for us.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
So
we
want to
be consistent with most other.
Well, we want to be consistent through the range of grades that we have. And quite frankly, this is the fourth high school that I've worked in two states, and I've never seen a 60 anything be a failing grade.
Mm-hmm.
But that was something you inherited.
Yeah.
And then he's been working with the faculty, you know, and you try to have the faculty engaged in, you know, and I guess recently that, you know, that people have been a little bit more interested in talking about
it. It wasn't unanimous, but it was a good majority.
Yeah, that's a tough one.
Yeah, it is a tough one.
Was this the only major inconsistency in the grades?
Yeah.
It's just this.
Mm-hmm. And obviously, I'm very happy to have RTI in effect and working to help all those, you know, students who are getting the 62s and the 61s. And I mean, they definitely
that's
need
not
support.
Where we want them to be, right?
No, but, you know.
But
you
should
sure
they fail and have to repeat, not get no credit or have to repeat the course?
What's in their best interest?
Yeah.
I mean, to encourage them to try harder, to move forward.
It's not black and white.
It's not black and white. No, it isn't.
We can move the vote.
Yeah.
I'm okay
well,
with that.
Well, you know, I mean, I'm...
Yeah.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter.
That's really good. Okay, we have some line item transfers.
Yes, you do.
We do.
I signed them.
Yeah, I put it.
Okay.
Okay, where does it start?
It was mostly to clean up accounts that were overspent.
Uh-huh.
Moving money around. You will see I did transfer some money out of special ed. We need to use a certain portion of our circuit breaker.
Mm-hmm.
So we did that. And if you notice on the second page, again, it was cleaning up accounts, but I did put the majority of the money that was left over into maintenance, because I had a real fear that when I was doing this that I wasn't sure what was going to be covered for the current situation with the storm, so I thought that was the best place to put the money for now.
Okay.
Hopefully we won't have any more storms.
Hopefully no more storms.
That's all. Okay, the chair will entertain a motion to approve line item transfers number 90 to 149 in the amount of $136,847.92.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move along and discuss the FY16 budget. Last meeting, we had a productive meeting, but we did say we'd go back and take a look. I know I needed some more time just to review it, which I did take that time. I hope it's given all of you enough time to take a look at it and be satisfied with it, and if we could have any discussions that anyone would like to bring forward.
I mean, I do have to, I thank you very much, both of you, Joan and Carol, for the extensive time-consuming work you've done on this, and I do totally agree that we're tightening the belt. I mean, big time. The 2 years ago, we increased the budget 4.6%. Last year, we increased it 3.37%. And this year, we're increasing it 2.46%. So that is significant. And, you know, it is a very lean budget. I appreciate the fact that you brought forth very good suggestions and how we do need to focus in the near future on raising revenue for our revolving accounts so that we can continue to, I mean, we provide an excellent education on a very lean budget, and it's not easy. And I know there's a lot of compromise and a lot of people who aren't getting, you know, what they want, but it's, you know, people, you're right. We appreciate people who passionately advocate for in the students, every student's best interest and what they believe, and a priority that I see that I'm very pleased to see is right in there. I want to support Peter's plan for the new high school courses, because I just think that I know it's important to give a good solid foundation to every grade at every school, but you know, our students are going to be, they're going off, and we want to prepare them to go off into the world and to be a success and be able to go off into college and beyond. And, you know, so the courses and the curriculum and the standards that we have now at the high school level are very pleasing to me. And I'm so glad mm-hmm. that we can support what's been put forth and what the proposal has been. And I hope we can keep on doing that. I know that we have had some cuts at the within the George the middle high school, minor supervisor and specialist positions, and that's difficult, but we're still putting forth a very high quality product, and I appreciate that.
Yeah, I also appreciate the time that both of you have spent,
well,
as well as
appreciate the administrative team. I mean, we sit together, it's not easy, especially when you, like Pam says, when you advocate for your own school, which you really are supposed to. That's the job of a principal, or in case of Donna and Julie, mm-hmm. you know, their departments. But as I note in the notes, you know, I mean, there's a lot of give and take. There's a lot of discussion about, you know, sort of rationale, why would we? And most importantly, it's about impact. Right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, our goal is to have the fewest mm-hmm. impacts that we can, you know, to the quality of the education we're trying to promote. But unfortunately, it's tough when you have to work within a bottom line. Right. I mean, our level services budget, if we did everything we did this year, our level services budget would have been about 3.3%. The town was very clear, you know, less than 2.5. And, you know, so, and they're still talking about reducing it further than that. Tonight, we have to talk about the $38,000 that we're still short from this budget that comes as a result of the bus bid coming in higher than we had anticipated. We budgeted 5%, and it was more than that. So we talked about that at the last meeting. As you know, we opened the bids the day before the meeting. So we, you know, we've met as administrative team, and you know, we're prepared to talk to you about how we can come up with $38,000 more. But that's the great challenge, is, you know, when you're given a bottom line, you know, you're opening a new building. I mean, there's a number of things that, you know, are factors that, you know, it was difficult this year. More as Pam said, you know, in the past we've had maybe, mm-hmm. you know, 3%, a little wiggle room. 4 was because we had higher special ed costs.
Right,
I mean, our budget usually increases about 3 to 3.5%, you know, with contractual obligations and all that. But, you know, the town is feeling in a tough shape this year. I mean, the new governor, no one really knows what the state aid. Everybody's waiting to find out, you know, what the impacts are going to be. And, you know, if there's more money, great, you know, but if there's not, you know, and the hard part is we do work within the construct of the town.
Right.
And we, even at 2.46%, we would be getting the highest percentage increase of any other town department. We are the biggest business, you know, it is more complicated to run the schools. I mean, my opinion is we run a small business. We have 200 employees, you know. You know, if we were out on the private, in the private sector, we'd be running a small business, right? There's a lot to it, and a lot of tough decisions need to get made when you have to live within a line that is lower than the budget that protects every single thing you have in the budget. Mm-hmm. So I think, as I explained last time, you know, there's the give and take, right? So you have to look at, you know, what are your overall goals? What do you need? And then if there's a place to move, that's what you try to do. But you don't, you know, all we really dealt with in this budget, even though we did make reductions, the middle high school, they were more shifts, because, you know, we have time and specialist schedules at the elementary that allow, you know, that there's no longer a need to teach sixth grade at the middle school. So some of those things were shifts or reductions, because we didn't actually have six, we were losing a whole class of kids at the middle high school. We would have loved to leave all of those positions there and be able to offer more electives. I'm sure that we would all do that. Mm-hmm. But when we determined, you know, sort of what do we actually absolutely have to provide, and then what would be nice if we could provide, that those were tough decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Those are tough decisions. And then you have contractual language. If you have a reduction in force, you know, there are people with professional teacher status who are qualified to teach the subject and have been teaching the subject that when you have to make a reduction, people do have the right in the contract to bump, you know, least senior people, and that's painful too. No one likes to do that. Trust me when I tell you, but if it's a difference of you're not going to be able to maintain your retirement, you know, then you, you know, you sort of fight for your own,
absolutely,
for what you need. It's understandable.
I'm sorry to bring this question to you now. Is there some place where we have summarized what are the cuts that we're making?
Mm-hmm. I mean, in the letter. So if you go to F behind tab A, mm-hmm, I lay out for you. So I lay out for you any new positions that we might have had to add because of the situation where we're opening a new school,
right?
And but we're keeping Pearly open. So like just one example is we still need to maintain a nurse there because we're not only maintaining our
right.
preschool program, we're adding to our preschool, and hopefully we're going to have a faculty daycare, and that's going to be more children. So we can't just move the nurse to Pembroke. We still have to maintain it there.
Right.
But we can't just leave one nurse for 770 students.
Now we have seven grades.
So that's something we have to add. Because
right, absolutely.
And then if you look at number four, there's a redirection of staff.
Right.
So like, for example, we know we have a special education teacher who teaches just sixth grade students who's retiring.
Mm-hmm.
So that position, because we're moving the sixth grade to Pembroke, that position's following, as are the salaries of five academic teachers.
Absolutely.
Okay. And the choral teacher, the way we solved the dilemma about being able to have a continuous program between fifth grade and seventh grade, we said we were going to offer during the music period, remember, music.
Yes.
But like, the teacher can't clone themselves. There has to be two teachers available during that.
Yeah, I understand. I guess, I read all this, and it
okay.
all made sense to me.
Okay.
So... I guess that we received an email tonight. You received
yes,
it as well
did,
from
yep.
members of the community
did,
about
yep.
a teacher, a specific teacher
mm-hmm.
whose work is being reduced.
That's
and
right.
I didn't see that listed here, so I wasn't aware.
Well,
of that,
because
so.
That
no,
that
it's not,
well,
it's not
what's
listed
book.
At the bottom
it's,
of that page,
it's
elementary the, specialist.
Right, it's
yeah.
a point one. There are two.
The
there are
bottom.
Two. There are
and
two elementary
at the very bottom.
Specialists. There's a PE and
okay,
a
I
music.
See.
So we wouldn't list that who it was for you
no,
anyway.
No, of course. No, of course. And all right.
Can you just? Mm-hmm. Would you mind just explaining that, just for
sure.
the people? Television audience as well as the people here.
Sure.
Because it is, when I first came onto the committee, two of these point ones and point fours, and,
yeah.
you know, it is, people don't understand that. So, and we did receive a couple of emails just before this meeting tonight in regards to those. So if we could just take the time
okay,
to
Okay, so let me just think of how I would explain it. So we have full-time employees, which is a 1.0 FTE. But we also have part-time employees that vary in the amount of time they work. So we might have a 0.5, which is obviously half the week. We might have 0.2s, which is 1 day a week.
Mm-hmm.
So if you think about it that way, 0.2 is 1 day, 0.4 is 2 days, 0.6 is 3 days, 0.4
sure.
is 8, and 1.0 is 5. So when you put together schedules, you determine how many sections you need for someone to teach. I mean, how many sections of children are there? And then you look at your FTEs and figure out how many teachers do you need. So in the music department, if we use that, currently we have 1.33 people. One
Four.
Full-time and one person who teaches 0.33 time, which is basically 2.5 days.
Elementary, so that's Pearly and Pembroke.
So, and that's how it's divided right now. You have one teacher, 1.0 at Pembroke, and then you have 0.33 at Pearly, because that's the number of sections that you need the teacher to teach. Of
course, we're consolidating now, right? So what we need in that consolidation is the equivalent of 1.2 teachers. So that accounts for the reduction of the 0.1.
Okay.
So there's still going to be 1.2 FTEs at the school next year. The challenge is that how that time gets divided is different, right? So that's when I'm saying to you about the professional teacher status. If you have someone, if you're going to reduce and you have someone who's got professional teaching status and someone who doesn't, before you can reduce the workload or the time for someone who's got professional teacher status, you need to, if there's someone with non-professional teacher status or someone who has less seniority, you have to reduce that person.
And that's stipulated in our teacher
contract. That's the contract. So it's not a loss. I mean, it is a loss of 0.1, but every student will get music. It'll just be different teachers that teach it. There'll still be the equivalent of 1.2 FTE teachers. So what it looks like is, right now, is 0.9 and 0.33. That's how that works.
Because some of the issue was that not all of the teachers were at full capacity, right?
That's right.
So you were
able to do this. Right. When you look at the number of sections you need,
right,
and then you're going to bring K and 1 and
right.
6 over the way the schedule would be right. blocked out. And you remember the teachers' negotiations has been everybody will get a planning time every day.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So
regardless of whether they're 0.3 or 1.0,
I think that varies a little if you're like 0.3, right. You know, but if you're a 1.0 teacher or 0.9 teacher, the expectation would be that you'd get planning time.
You would get planning time.
You know, sometimes it's prorated, but you know, it is always I mean, reductions are always difficult because they're people, right? And they're people we care about.
Yes.
And that is the hardest part of it. But I think the thing to remember is that it does affect individual people, but the amount of teaching time that's provided for in the budget is still the same amount of time.
Right. Yeah, and I think that's the big piece, is that there's, like you said, there's no loss of services, and you could see based on Peter's presentation that we're still even enhancing.
Right. I mean, there are some real reductions at the middle high school, but again, it comes down to now there's no sixth grade to teach.
Right. So
Let's be clear. There will be, you know, some consolidation of classes. So some of the classes might be a little higher. Maybe they won't be able to offer every elective that they currently offer.
You mean when you say some classes will be a little higher, do you mean enrollment in those
classes? Class sizes.
Yeah, class size will go up.
Yeah.
So
Peter will need to work that out when he does the schedule. I mean, when we looked at that, we absolutely knew there, you know, that was a potential consequence.
So, excuse me for my ignorance on this.
No questions are silly.
If you want to... How does one lobby the town, I mean, in terms of, you know, to establish budget priorities for the schools? Like, I understand the town of Georgetown is stretched pretty tight.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, you know, so my passion is education.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I want to go to the town and say, I am passionate about education. Mm-hmm. I want our schools to not suffer.
Mm-hmm.
Because I do feel like since... my first night on this committee where I had to sit in on a vote to cut programs from the high school, I was horrified.
Yeah.
And I continue to be horrified by what I perceive as a lack of support. But I don't sit on those committee meetings and I don't know. So I hesitate to judge, you know, my neighbors too harshly. And yet I just wonder what's the vehicle for that.
Well, I mean, generally, through this process, you've got the budget, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can... So right now, this is the superintendent's recommended budget based on the parameters we were asked to work within. The school committee always has the ability to vote a higher budget and bring it to the FinCom. Because after you vote this budget,
right,
you're going to go to the Finance Advisory Board, and you're going to make your case, whether it's this budget or a budget that's modified. And then they're going to tell you what your bottom line is.
Absolutely.
And then if they, so if you say, well, we want to add all these things back in and we're going to give you a 3.46 budget increase, which you can do. But when you go to FinCom, if they say, well, guess what? You're getting $200,000 new money. Then we're going back in this budget and cutting it.
I understand.
That process is a little harder sometimes. Not to say it can't be done.
Didn't we do it last year?
We didn't do it because we got the technology direct. There was an amendment to the budget, but I don't
there
think we cut it.
Had taken our liabilities for our retirements.
Oh, so that was
you
different.
Reduced it, but they paid it on the town
they
side.
They paid it, so it wasn't a something that came out of us. But
again, it came from us saying that we really had a larger budget than what they had told us that we could work with. And so they worked with us.
Yes.
To get us the money by taking on something.
That's correct.
That they
and
could
that,
take
that
on.
Conversation happened when you went to FinCon. So that obviously that can happen. You know, I think it's going to be tough this year. I mean, just following the emails today on snow and ice.
I know.
And the cost of snow and ice. I mean, they might have $58,000 left in snow and ice. I mean, in free cash. You know, we could lobby them for more buses. We could lobby them for the maintenance person that Mike Anderson is concerned about that we aren't including this year.
Those are some of the things I know that we've talked about when we've talked about what would we like to see in Georgetown.
Yeah.
And it's not just these cuts. I mean, there's things that we talked about that we would like to see that never even made it into this budget that have been parts of our discussions at various committee levels. So that's really concerning to me. And
it's
disconcerting. We have bus issues in this town
that
budget doesn't address.
That's right.
And it's as if almost.
Well, I think that's one of the items that we actually said that we'd talk about lobbying for.
We might speak to them about it.
Right. So I think as you look at this, you got to look down this list. And say, what are the things that you disagree with that you'd lobby for? I mean, I have to say, as I look through this, and I've been through it a number of times now, I don't think there's anything right here that I would lobby for.
Okay.
I'd say that this is thoughtful and it makes good financial sense. I would absolutely, though, lobby for the additional buses.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. What I don't know is that we have a list of sort of the key things that we would lobby for.
Well, I don't think we discussed that. Yeah, you're right.
Right.
We could have that conversation.
Definitely.
You prioritize them, you mean?
No, she said.
I don't even think we have an actual list of, you know, these are the five things that we'd attempt to lobby for.
But
I mean, the buses would probably be at the top.
Well, usually at the beginning of the process, and maybe that's just because it was not as pertinent then as it feels right now.
Right.
But we always start the budget process saying, what are the school committee's budget priorities?
Mm-hmm. Right.
What would you like us
to
think about when we're working with this budget? And we don't tend to get tons of feedback, but I think it's the time. Right now, of course, it's easier to say, gee, I don't see this here, that here, or this is coming
out.
Well,
I think also it's the feel of the town, too. It's
we
have, you know, I have things
I
would love to see, too, but I'm saying with the amount of money that we are told to work with.
Right.
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 You know,
we,
how
we
reasonable is
our
it?
Priorities before, but
right.
then we're told, you know, to submit a budget that's less than 2.5%.
Right.
So.
Well, I think from what I'm understanding from the town fathers, I guess I'd call them that, is that this particular year is really challenging for people because there's, you know, not only are they still adding or living through the sort of impact of the override, but now the new school is really hitting people kind of heavily. So I think they're feeling very strongly that, you know, the budget overall in town can't go up more than the 2.5% that they, you know, that it can happen without going for an override or something. So I think when they're looking at the needs of all the town departments, I mean, Joan and I have seen some preliminary stuff. I mean, their department's getting 1.1%, you know. So it doesn't look like anybody's getting a big increase.
And I can understand that. The taxpayers have been very, very
well, and
generous.
That's, and that's,
year
I think,
year
what they're feeling
year,
is
we
this
really
particular
want to
year
how to live with what we
is,
have.
Is tough because
yes.
of just the fact that so many new things are coming on board. So
yes.
So I don't know if in 2 years or 3 years, as time goes on, that's going to be as big a deal, but I guess the sense is that this year is a big
this
deal.
This year it is.
Plus, you've got this change in state government that no one really knows what's going to happen with that.
Right.
You know, all you hear is these billion-dollar deficits, and then you've got the health insurance crisis that continues to plague, you know, plague
right.
not only our district, but our town, but
you know,
countrywide.
I mean, it's, you know, if the healthcare costs go up 5, 6, 7, 8%, that really is a challenge for towns. The other thing that Mike has talked about is the significant increase in cost of vocational education. He's got a $100,000 bill he didn't have a plan to pay for because, you know, the assessments at Whittier and the assessments at Essex Aggie.
The last meeting you
were not Essex Aggie, Essex Tech. Go up, you know, you're talking $18,000 to $20,000 a student. So when you get a bill that, you know, you get a $100,000 bill that you're not planning on. So I think that there's a number of things that the town is juggling. I firmly believe if they had their druthers, you know, they would give us what we feel like we need, as long as we could justify it. And I've always felt that we've been successful. I mean, you don't get a $1.2 million override in the worst economy in the world if you don't, people don't have some trust that you are going to do what you said you're going to do, and you need it for the reasons you need it. So I think we have built some credibility. You know, we've had years where the town approved $250,000 in extraordinary special ed costs without asking a question, mm-hmm. right? And then left it in our base so that we would not have to worry about a $250,000 deficit the next year. So I look at those things over the years, and I think, well, you know, and you know, we're not last in per pupil spending anymore. We're 14th.
We used to be.
Still nothing to be all excited about, but it's 14th, you know, as opposed to dead last every single year.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, again, there just isn't enough to go around is what I guess I'm hearing. And, you know, I think we should always advocate for what we need. And I think that what we try to do when we meet with FinCom is say, these are the things that are in the budgets, but these are the things. That's why arguing for the maintenance guy and arguing, you know, for, you know, a bus.
Right.
You know, I mean, those are things that the community should know.
Right.
You have kids that aren't getting home till 4:15 in the afternoon. Right. You know, we've got a brand new building coming online with a very sophisticated system, and we haven't added the maintenance guy this year. We're talking about doing it next year, because the fields are going to come online. I can read you an email that Mike put together because he, you know, he's feeling strongly that it's not a good idea for us not to add the maintenance guy this year.
Absolutely.
It means if we add the maintenance guy, it means another $40,000 we have to find on top of the 38 that we're going to find. So it's just, it's juggling the balls and figuring out where you want the balls to land. And it's not easy, no matter how you look at it. It's just not easy. And we're using, as you know, we're using revolving accounts to make sure we don't have to reduce services, and we're raising revenue. We're going to set up a faculty daycare. We're going to try to do an 18 to 22-year-old program for not only our special ed students that deserve a nice transition into, you know, from school into life, and inviting other communities to come in on a tuition basis because they need it as well.
Sure.
You know, we're adding to the preschool so we can, you know, meet the needs of the customer to a greater extent.
And possibly selling seats on the buses.
And possibly selling seats on the buses. So, I mean, we're trying to help ourselves out.
Yes.
You know, rather than go back to the town and say, okay, town, now you need to give us a lot more money.
Right.
But, you know, you can only sustain that for so long.
Absolutely.
That's the point.
Okay. I have a question about so music at the elementary level.
Yes.
The band program, now my kids I have a seventh grader, he's my youngest, so I'm not quite familiar with how the elementary works right now with band. But what I remember is they would go in the morning or they'd stay late.
Yes.
And they would get band.
That still happens, right, Tyler?
Yeah.
That happens this year.
Yes, it's okay. It's been happening, but has it always been before school, Tyler?
Is it before or after, or both?
I do both.
Oh,
you do
okay.
He does both.
So go forward basis, will that happen next year?
That was the plan, that would continue to happen.
That's still
yep.
fine. Okay.
But that isn't part of a regular teacher's teaching load, right? That's an extra.
Yes, but Tyler gets a stipend for
that's,
it.
That's.
Okay, I was just
for it's the equivalent of a teaching position, another teaching position, if
yes.
he does it every single day.
Yes.
But he gets and there's a stipend in the teacher's contract, and then he
that's
works with the after school program,
right.
And they figure out how that works.
And that's not being impacted at
nope.
all by this.
No. Nope.
That is still
no.
Nope.
Yeah.
Okay.
Does that help, Barbie?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay.
So can you explain, I'd be curious if anything you've outlined is impacted by the $38,000 that we have to come up with.
Okay.
Oh, right.
Well.
No.
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 So what we did when we sat together, we put a bunch of things up there. Some were, let's say, less palatable than others. But we went in and we tried to figure out, like, okay, what, so we have a budget in our schools for lunch aids at Pembroke. So remember, we're consolidating two schools. So there will be some movement of some people from Pearly that are going to Pembroke. And in talking with the teachers, one of the things that they actually pointed out is that there is a, in the schedule, what is it, Schedule C, B, or A? A is
C.
C. In Schedule C, that there is actually a position called cafeteria monitor or something. I'm making it up. But it's in there. So if there are teachers who would like to volunteer, I guess, to supervise lunch, they would be paid for that on a weekly basis. And so we're hearing from the union that there probably are a number of teachers who would appreciate the opportunity to do that. The good news for us would be that we would be able to support the paraprofessionals that are already doing the work.
Yes.
So we thought it was possible to take $10,000 out of the lunch aids, given that we might have a different way to do it. You know, that doesn't mean any lunch, I don't want any lunch aides that might be hearing this to think, oh my God, I'm losing my job. It'll probably be a reduction of hours is okay. how we'll effectively get that done. And then, you know, looking at long-term subs and middle high school subs, Peter has this very creative way, I guess, of his sub lines are not always spent, overspent. So we thought we could take $5,000 out of the middle high school subs, and then out of the long-term subs, take $5,000.
So we're up to 20.
And then, if you recall, we did take two paraprofessionals out of the Pembroke for next year. And so we're proposing to take one paraprofessional out of the middle high school. So I think they're currently, Donna, you have to help me, there's like 15 or 16 paras there, right? And at Margaret's school, there's 35 or so, right? Something like that. So, you know, we don't like this, but we're really struggling to come up with places to find $38,000.
So what would that's on top of the...
That's 18.
That's 18,000?
For the para. Yeah, for the one para. And well, I'm not saying that's going to be easy. It's going to require, you know, Donna and Peter and Allison and all the folks over there to take a look at exactly how they might be able to do that and support the students.
Did we already lose?
What does this para?
You already lost two. And okay. This para.
Can you just explain?
I don't think that they've decided which para.
Okay. I mean, what they.
What? I'm sorry, Pam. What?
Well, this para professional. What would not be getting done if we didn't have them?
Nothing would not be getting done. They would probably reorganize services so that there might be, you know, the way they would set up the programs would be such that they might have to switch the staff around. So that's how it's going to be. So, you know, we don't know that.
Work for
you have to, yeah. So you wouldn't take like somebody who's got a one-to-one paraprofessional on their ed plan and just suddenly not do it anymore.
Right.
So there are paraprofessionals.
The IEPs.
Right.
Yeah.
All the
obviously.
IEPs would follow.
Yes.
Followed. But they would, it might be, it wouldn't be a one-to-one, but it might be, you know, if you have two kids that have high-level support, maybe there's a third, you know. They have program paraprofessionals. They have inclusion paraprofessionals. So it really is up to Donna and that crew to figure out the sort of, you know, what might be there.
Are all paraprofessionals involved in special education? Are there some that don't, that are not involved in special education?
No, there's some paraprofessionals there's kindergarten paraprofessionals.
Right.
There's preschool paraprofessionals.
Okay.
There's special ed paraprofessionals. Yeah,
okay.
The rest are special ed.
Okay.
So I don't think the decision about the actual body, who it would be, or, you know, has been made, but the recommendation is right now.
So
it's not one we are all thrilled about, but $38,000, as I said, is not a small amount of money to come up with in a budget that you've really scrutinized.
Yeah.
You know.
Lean and mean as it is already.
So that doesn't have to go by seniority?
That's why we don't know who the body is, because yes, it does. There does have some, although the GESA contract, the GESA contract is a little different than the GEA contract.
Correct.
In that there's 4 or 5
I think it was missing
criteria that you consider, like needs of the district, level of training. You know, there's a number of seniority is one of them, but it's not the driver. Yeah. Whereas in some contracts, seniority is the trump card.
Right.
So,
Lorene,
we tend to try to support seniority, obviously, but it's a matter of, you know, there are other factors that mm-hmm. you can use, especially with something as important as the paraprofessionals, because Donna puts a lot of time and effort into training people for certain kinds sure. of programs. So you wouldn't just yank somebody who was really...
How much of that paraprofessional, budget line is supported by the special education budget?
It's charged to special education.
It's all charged to special education.
Right. It's, Donna has the district-wide special education budget that you see on the special ed page.
Right.
But then there's special ed in each of the buildings. So right. it is mm-hmm. part of the special education cost.
Okay.
So when you look at
I suppose my concern is, what if, we go and we cut that $38,000 mm-hmm. in that way, and we sit down in the fall, and Donna doesn't have adequate staffing to meet, the demands of all the IEPs or whatever our special ed population turns out to be in the fall, then what happens?
Then we have to find the money.
That's right. That's right.
I hate to tell you, that's what you have to do.
I know. That's what I'm saying. So I don't want to put us in a position where, like, legally, mm-hmm. I don't think we need any lawsuits from parents who are saying the district is unable to meet the demands of my child's.
No, that's just...
And so it seems a little bit of a scary place mm-hmm. to cut. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't know, not that I have a better idea, because I tried to go through this.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's hard, because it's like, especially, mm-hmm. I'm not in the school every day, I'm not a school administrator, so it's hard to understand where these numbers come from and this, that, and other. So I trust the administration in Georgetown is doing the best they can, but that, to me, just... Mm-hmm.
Well, when we've been in that situation before, and believe me, I think this is the year to say that we've been in that situation where we've had to add additional paraprofessionals, which are all maintained in this budget.
Yes.
You have to find the money.
Yeah.
And sometimes what we'll find is, we hire teachers leave at a higher salary. We hire somebody less expensive, so that money's available in the budget. Or you see what we have to do. Sometimes we freeze the budget.
Would we be able to go to the town? Budget. They've been supportive of us in the past
I wouldn't rule something like that right. out. I mean, we do have our circuit breaker funds, which help us with some of our
responses. The salary line items, do they take into consideration how many retirements we might be having?
Absolutely.
They do.
So we know the retirement, so we budget the replacement cost at Master Step 6. $56,000.
Donna can tell you this because she's worked other places. A lot of school budgets, where the money is, right, where the little pools of money are, is in salaries, because they'll budget. So let's say somebody's retiring at $65,000. They'll leave $65,000 in the budget.
Sure.
And so then you hire somebody at 50.
And
look
at
that. How you to do that
I
for 10
feeling
people.
You weren't doing that, we're but not I doing wanted that. You to we, say we that in that. A
we
public
we
forum.
Have, we have done that every year. We've been completely honest with that. We budget at Master's 6. Now, that doesn't mean that we're going to hire somebody at Master's 6, but that's what we budget. We don't keep the money hidden in the budget. Yeah. The other thing that happens is usually a special education director will stick in there an extra tuition and transportation so that you don't run into a situation like this.
Donna, did you do that?
We never do that.
She wishes.
She said, and I mentioned it before, she said, my superintendent won't let me. But it's definitely what most bed directors do, because there will be things that come up, or there is a student who student needs to move, who moves in that comes with a paraprofessional on their IEP, and we don't have one. So definitely, it's a concern. What this forces us to do is go back in again and look at, exactly, do we need to have all of the services for some kids that, you know, that we're currently providing? Do we have some students who are aging out or, you know, have made improvements? We just have to, Donna and Margaret and Peter need to, and their staffs need to go in and really try to figure out, like, where can this be done? And then again, if we run into a situation where we absolutely, something happens and we can't do it, we have to find the money.
Yeah. So Carol, are we saying that what was already built into the budget is a reduction of two paraprofessionals?
That's right.
And now
this would be a third.
You know what, it didn't make the letter though as a reduction?
Oh, it didn't?
No.
It was in your orange notes.
Well, let me, okay, so let me, so let me just.
So
this brings it's a total of three.
Oh, I think I did it from reduction from the middle high school. Okay, so let me just think of how I can amend that when we put this back together. So we're looking at reducing, three paras. Okay, I'll figure that out.
So I guess my question more is around, now that it's three, are we still saying that there's no reduction in services? Because we're saying that we've got the capacity of three?
Well, we won't provide services. The question is, you know, how we provide them. You know, maybe we have some students who can, you know, who can do well with an aide that sort of oversees three students instead of just two. Because kids have all kinds of different needs and varieties. I mean, that's something that occurs to me.
Right.
Or, you know, if we organize kids in classrooms where we have like two or three special ed kids in one class, right? And then we can put the aide to support them there. If we put a special ed child in every class and then we have to have an aide to supervise, there's what I'm talking about, right? So it might force us to take a look at, which isn't a bad thing. Donna's been talking about this now for a couple of years. How can we better utilize our staff? Because do you see the difference? If you have five sections of a class, mm-hmm. and you say, we've got a couple of teachers who really do well with special education students, rather than putting the special education students across the board in everybody's class, right? And then expecting there to be an aide to support them in five, now you need five paraprofessionals, right. Where you could potentially, if you consolidate them into a couple of sections, then you can provide more support to the students in that classroom and to the teacher working with those students.
So that's what the direction we're moving in for next year.
That's right.
It almost sounds like you have to do that every year before we even make this recommendation, though.
I'm sorry, Lorraine, what do you mean? Yes, we always look at our staffing every year.
Right, but you have to analyze what you need for paraprofessionals.
Correct.
Before we can.
Mm-hmm. I'm not telling you that next year we won't need to add a paraprofessional in the budget.
What I'm saying is we need to do that analysis, I think, before we make that decision.
For this year?
Yeah. No, I think.
I think Donna and
I think what she's saying, though, is if these three paraprofessionals we could certainly use.
Right, of course you could.
But we're
looking at doing a few things
to get
differently
rid of money. Right.
That are not gonna.
Okay, so we know we need them. Is that what we're saying?
We would prefer them.
We would
in
prefer
the
them.
We would prefer them.
Yeah,
but they're not required by.
You're not.
I said
not
serviceable
right.
on IEPs.
IEP.
Okay.
According to the services on their grids.
Doesn't matter. Right. Looking at instructional grouping.
Yeah.
What kind of progress students.
So an IEP would never, or I don't know. It might not specify that a specific student needs one-on-one attention.
That's right.
And
right.
So, and in the case where that's not specified, that student could be placed in a group of a certain size at your discretion, depending on the needs,
right.
with a paraprofessional who would
right.
be supporting.
Right.
Based on the professional
right.
input of the special ed teachers and related service providers. So we sit
right.
there and we take a look at what the student's needs are, how they're best served. Because what you don't want as well are one-on-ones unless they're medically necessary for students or for safety reasons. Otherwise, what happens are your students then become dependent upon that adult intervention.
You want to build.
So you really don't want that one-on-one situation.
I see. Okay.
Right.
But you do want to provide the support that's necessary, and
right.
that. But there, I guess what we're saying is there are different models with which we can do that.
Okay.
And right. that's why we're looking at this as a reduction as opposed to a teaching position.
Well, that's a.
That's comforting.
I hate to see any of them go because we didn't require them.
I hate to see any of these cuts.
Yes, absolutely.
We have how many overall in total? How many do we have in total paraprofessionals?
45.
There's about
47.
15 at the middle high school and then about 35 for the elementary.
And then you have kindergarten has 5, and then you have preschool that has another 5.
So that's a lot. Wait a minute. So how many?
I think it's about 47.
Right.
I got a count
right.
on the other day.
All of the
total.
Preschool ones?
Total. Preschool.
It could be 47.
Preschool.
Yeah.
Kindergarten.
It was definitely under 50. Because when we did the whole negotiations with that union.
It was like 47.
But I think what we did, too,
we have added a lot,
which was a positive step, was to reevaluate the their job
description.
That's right.
Because we really didn't have what we needed.
That there were different, like Barbie's absolutely right. So there were kindergarten aides and preschool aides that were really supporting the teacher and the students.
Right.
But then there was another category of paraprofessionals that were really doing data collection, you know, instructional teaching under the direction of a special ed teacher. And so that actually warranted a different pay scale, and that's what we did.
Very specialized training that we provided for them.
Right. Sure.
So that's when Carol was talking about looking at the criteria of the paraprofessionals we need, depending on the type of training they have and the type of students that needs we have. And then you're going to look at that and match that as well. And that's a very important piece.
So I guess if you looked at the overall population of paraprofessionals that you have, we're saying that we're going to reduce that staff by probably only about 2.5%, if I did the math in my head right. And I guess with any process in life, you can probably get 10% efficiency by doing almost anything.
Yeah.
So I guess that number feels better to me now.
Yeah.
It didn't before. Okay.
those are great questions.
I'm just
believe me, that particular cut was the last one that was on the table, and it was the hardest to make.
Well, you think about 3, and it feels like a big number, but it doesn't feel so big if you've got
47,
I guess, across.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if we weren't looking at maybe doing things in a little different way, then I think it would be really harder. But, you know, I think Margaret and Donna putting their heads together with Sandy and the special ed teachers, and you know, I think I'm optimistic that they're gonna do well by the kids, but at the same time, maybe create some efficiencies that we've been trying to struggle with this year, trying to figure it all out. Mm.
And I know you talked a little bit about the uncertainty with a new governor, but have you heard anything about what the next circuit breaker reimbursement?
They haven't talked about cutting circuit breaker any further. Supposedly, the stuff I read the other day said Charlie Baker has a balanced budget. Hmm. So I'm thinking that's optimistic that
too.
It doesn't mean we're necessarily going to be facing. And clearly, they said they didn't anticipate any further local, cuts to cities and towns and local aid, especially. But they're the Chapter 70 formula is being reworked, and what did they say the state budget was going to go? Didn't we talk about 4.something% today? What was that we were talking about? I thought it was something to do with the state budget. We read in that Beacon magazine or whatever.
Oh, the state revenue projection.
Oh, the state revenue projection. So that was up, 4%? But I don't know if they've figured that into the budget. I mean, I don't really know. We're trying to keep on top of it. I mean, I think there is supposed to be some new budget information coming out within the next week anyway. I mean, that's the hard part when you go to FinCom because that's why we always ask to be delayed till March, because you don't really know anything about state funding.
They don't vote on their budget until the end of June.
Right, we could put a budget together in November. The town could put a whole budget together in November, but then you don't know what you're talking about for state aid. So what if you get more money? What are you going to do, go back and say to people here, most of the time, the budget you make is the budget that sticks.
Mm-hmm.
So we've always said it doesn't really make sense for everybody to go crazy getting these budgets together if you don't have any really good numbers on state aid. Mm-hmm. So that's why FinCom always talks to the schools last. Because, our budget is the most contingent, on the state information.
Well, that's a big concern, though. If we go to FinCom, we don't know if they're going to stamp their approval on this. And
we don't. I mean, I have to say, you know, FinCom has some new folks on the FinCom. Mm-hmm. Of course, you know, there's some, you know, people like Sandy Garrity and Jim Lacey who, you know, have been doing budgets, you know, probably mm-hmm. for longer than they want to admit. But, you know, a couple of the newer members have asked to come in and meet with me. I've gone, you know, they want, their questions are less about, you know, what is your actual budget? Their questions are more about how do you build it? How do you make decisions about what goes into it? What is the process of building a school budget? And I've actually met personally with two of them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I feel like the benefit that they got out of that was that they have a lot more understanding about how of all the nuances of what goes into a school budget and how do revolving accounts work, that, you know, even if we only have a $13.9 million budget, we run a $15 million operation with the grants and revolving accounts and other sources of revenue that we have to also manage, and all of the limitations of those things.
Right.
You know, so I was really happy. Sandy Garrity had suggested to both of them that they come in and see, and they called me right away, and they were great. They were very interested, and I think felt like it was useful. So I would welcome anybody from FinCom or Board of Selectmen to do that, because I think that's how you know, when you understand the nuances of it.
Yeah.
It's not just a set of numbers. There's a story behind it. Painful as it can be sometimes, but you know.
Well, I think that's why Dave Surface, the Board of Selectmen, Dave Surface, has always said mm-hmm. he believes that anyone in local government should be on the FinCom.
Yes,
that should be like a prerequisite,
mm-hmm.
just so you can get a better idea of how
mm-hmm.
things are done, and I can see where he's coming from
yeah.
with that.
Mm-hmm. And I would say
it's
that
not personally something
FinCom should have been on
school committee. Certainly not a position I would like to be in. FinCom math is not my forte.
No, that's a tough job.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of tough decisions there too.
Right, and with the few emails that I did get today, that you all got as well, it, you know, they ended it with saying, you know, please look elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying, there's just, as you can see,
there aren't a lot of places
to yeah,
look.
You know, it's unfortunate to say that, but it's just
it is
difficult every year.
Can you send me those when you get a chance? I wouldn't mind taking a peek at them.
The emails?
This is my ongoing challenge with
you didn't,
emails.
Oh, you didn't get them? Yes,
I'll
forward them.
There's
oh, yeah.
probably about a third of the conversation here that I hear. Couple of
I wonder why.
Then.
Well, I know you've talked to Wes. Did you have you
I've
talked
to everyone? I
well, no,
even,
we'll talk to Wes. I don't know. The
I've even tested
of
it with Laura. I don't get it.
Well, let me talk to Wes.
Well, if you notice, sometimes I put your
yes.
business email
yeah.
on there as well.
Do you get the things I send you? I send them
I don't
to
know.
You.
It's hard to know what
know.
You don't
if you get them.
But you always respond, so I'm assuming
then
you get them.
Yeah, that I must.
Okay.
I wonder if your email address is listed wrong.
Well, someone did find an issue with it back a few months ago.
Okay,
and
I'm going
to
ask
it was
Wes.
Corrected.
Okay,
but I don't know if it was the address. I don't know what it was.
Okay,
but these
well,
emails
oh.
I didn't get any of.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh,
well,
I know you're on there.
Yeah.
Listed.
No.
So I'll forward them to.
Okay. Yeah. You forward those
okay.
and I'll check to Wes.
Yeah.
Check with Wes.
Yeah.
So Carol, are we thinking about? So we're going in with what the town asked for. Are we then thinking of asking for additional funding for the two buses and building a case?
Well,
for that?
The two buses, from what I recall, and I wrote the numbers down. The two buses, I believe it was 137, but just let me verify that.
No, it's 106.
Nope, not according to what I wrote down.
Mm-hmm.
I know that doesn't sound familiar to me. Just if you give me 1 second, I know I have this written down.
You're looking for the amount for the
I'm
two buses?
I'm just looking for it. There's
the
I had it for the three, the two, and the one. Do you have it shown there, Kate?
Well, each bus is $295 a day.
Yeah, the
times
number.
Times two times 180. That's what I just did.
Okay, that's fine then. The number I know I wrote down that from our conversation was higher than that. I am positive it was higher than that. But, you know, if you've got that number and that's how you're figuring it, we'll go with that. What do you have
six.
It for? What do you have it for six?
For an extra bus?
Yeah.
Half of that.
So what? So
53.1.
What I have here is seven buses, is 143,010. 6 was 89,910, and 5 was 36,810. I don't know.
Is that because you were selling?
No. This is what the conversation you
seven
and I had.
Seven buses, 371,7.
371,7, I got that, yeah.
So it's divided by 7. It's cost per bus. It's 53,1.
Yeah, I thought the cost per bus was 295 per day per bus, yep. And each bus was 53,100 for the year. Okay, well, these are numbers I wrote.
You know why? Because we were talking about getting rid of the transportation.
Okay, so let's not confuse everybody. What are those numbers again?
So does that still factor into that?
Well, we had to put them back into the budget.
We put them back in. We wouldn't take the whole amount out. We'd take 20, I think we said we'd leave 25 in and we'd take the difference out. Or we take 25 out and leave the other part in there because we still have people that would have to supervise.
So would it be asking more for 80,000 as opposed to like 106?
I don't know. I guess we should probably
build that case. And then even if we said we're going to subsidize at a very low level.
So Joan, tell me again what were seven buses
then
was.
Asking 375,000.
No, just the Ed number. How much are we looking for seven buses, the difference between what we budgeted and what we need?
You've got the 38 in there. That's the thing. You've got the 38 in
okay.
there.
Okay.
So we're looking for 106.
We're looking for 106.
But we were looking for the 38 too, because when we went to bid, we didn't have that number in there.
Okay, so then the six buses you're saying would be
the difference.
Yeah, just the same thing. Like, because we've already got money in the budget for five buses.
Right.
So the question is, how much are we short?
For two buses,
it's 106.
106.
For one bus, it's
53,1.
53,1.
Would we ever ask for one bus?
Well, that's not something you should completely rule out.
Right.
That's okay. Better than five.
Better than five.
And then, obviously, the one is 30, what do we say? One set five buses to maintain it. We wanted 38, right?
We needed 38 too.
Yeah.
We needed 38 in cuts.
Right. 38 in cuts.
Or 38 added to our budget.
Right. So
if we asked for two buses, though, we would take a portion of the 38 off the 106. Because you don't need
We would cut the 20. I thought it was 25, but it could. We'd have to get a number because we'd have to know how many people. But let's say, we would cut even if we just cut 20.
Yeah. Right.
In transportation aids.
So then you
could look at, you know, if you had seats to sell, you know, which we probably would, even if we had six buses, I think we might have seats to sell.
I don't think you'd have as many as you projected.
In seven buses, Barbie, or six? You mean in terms of people taking advantage of it or having the number of seats?
No, people taking advantage of it.
Okay.
I just didn't want to, I was concerned about putting that particular amount in there because I just thought it was high.
Yeah, we were talking, I remember, if we had seven buses, we were talking about even if we just used five of those buses.
Yeah, I think it was 80,000, right?
And put an additional 20 kids on each bus. Right.
$200 then per.
At $200 per.
Mm-hmm.
That's where we would
come
in.
Even if you cut that in half, though.
Mm-hmm.
As a proposal to the town.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I mean, you have nothing to lose. All they can do is say no.
Right. It feels like
we can justify the need,
mm-hmm.
but if there are some other ways to sort of subsidize it, even if you estimate it very low.
So let's just say we were going after 106, because that's not in the budget right now, okay? And we were able to take 20 off of that. So let's just round it to 100 just to make nice numbers, right? So now we're down to 80, right?
90.
Sorry, not what did I say? 100 minus 20.
80.
Oh, isn't it 106 minus 20?
I know, I'm rounding.
She's just
rounding it. I'm rounding
86.
It
off. Okay.
I'm rounding it off. I like not round numbers.
Okay, sorry.
So you get 80. Okay, so I'll give you that. 86. There we go.
That's my Brett mine tonight.
So yeah, Joan and the calculator.
86.
So 86. So again, now even if we estimate what we could potentially raise in revenue, what numbers do you want to work with on that?
Well, you were saying 20 seats.
Yeah, and 5 buses.
Per bus.
I was saying 100 seats.
That's high.
Yeah, I think it's high.
Okay.
Well, maybe it's
so,
you ask
so,
for the 86.
So do it, so
I
do
would
it
say,
in half.
Yeah,
so do it
I would
half.
Say 5
so,
to 10
okay.
seats.
Okay, so let's say you have 50 seats
mm-hmm.
in that case at 200.
10,000.
Okay. Hmm? 10,000. Right. So then now you're down to 76.
Still a good number.
Still
a high
number.
Yeah, it is.
So that's why if you look, I mean, just for the sake of discussion, sometimes the way you get things is to put them in a phase-in kind of mode. So if you, just for the sake of discussion, if you had 6 buses, now you're looking at 53, right? So you take out 20, you take out 30. Now you're talking 23. That might be a more...
Well, you'll get some experience with the one bus, right?
With the what?
You'll get some experience if you just add one bus and see...
Would you still be able to save that much in transportation supervision, do you think?
Right.
Well, why would you think we wouldn't? What would?
Well, how many kids would be for that lack of a bus?
Who would still go
I
on
guess
a
we'd
run,
have,
a
I
double
guess,
run?
I guess we'd have to ask Barry if we'd still have to. It wouldn't be worth doing it if you still have a double run.
Exactly. That's what
so
I'm saying.
So I guess we'd have to ask
what's
Barry
going to eliminate
that.
The double run? And, like, yeah, we
yeah,
need
completely.
Barry here to tell us.
And you're meeting with Barry.
How to advocate.
Said,
scheduled Barry, yeah.
Yeah.
So I'll...
So if 6 would eliminate the double run, that could be worth advocating for. If it wouldn't...
Yeah, yeah, right, exactly,
you know,
I agree.
Mm-hmm. I don't know that it would make much sense.
And can you put kids that are within a mile?
Your policy
right, it is
says
one and a half. Right.
So you can certainly
sell seats to anybody that's under that 1.5.
That's right.
All right, because I was under the impression we were doing
to any
one.
High school students, anybody, any
you could 7th sell, through 12th grade.
7th through 12th grade. You,
right,
you
just
charge,
elementary
you're
required.
We don't support
okay.
that, so, well, we don't all support it. Right, Joan?
I support it.
I know she does. I wasn't going to throw you
and
under
she
the
doesn't,
bus,
well,
though.
She doesn't live in town here, so she can say
it. Everywhere I've lived, everywhere I've worked, they've paid.
It is more common than you think.
Does Beverly pay?
Absolutely. $350 a year for anybody that's not eligible according to state law.
Wow.
Hmm. And guess what? People pay.
What does the state law say? I mean, what's
sixth grade?
Yeah. We only have to provide busing up to sixth grade.
Yeah.
Right. For 1.5 miles or out.
Unless the sixth grade is part of an elementary school.
No.
No, in sixth grade you
just
provide. So, like
yeah.
in middle school,
oh, okay.
Beverly,
okay.
sixth grade gets transportation
so if
free.
2 miles from the high school?
Then you should be eligible for a bus. Well, actually.
But if you lived in another town, you'd be paying for that bus.
Right.
In seventh grade.
Right.
In,
right.
Even
right.
if
That's
it's
right.
5 miles from the high school.
The state says that you only have to transport up to grade 6.
Okay.
Even if grade 6 is in a middle school with 7th and 8th.
Right, so
seventh
your sixth graders would get dropped off and your poor little seventh graders would be out of luck.
Oh, the parents pay.
Or the parents pay, there you go.
Is there any additional work we can do on how many kids actually use the bus, even though they ask for a pass? Because I know we talked about that, too.
Yeah.
That we actually think there's probably more seats available than we even realize.
Right, so
that's why I think there are more
buses.
Seats
available than we realize.
I contacted in the state, and the law is you can't charge those students, because we thought
I'm not thinking of charging
actually,
them, but
we thought if we could
really
charge them something that they would maybe
yeah,
commit.
I wanted to charge them
it
a non-refundable
to the
registration
run.
Fee,
right. You know,
so that you know you committed, you committed to the
what is
riding of the bus, but
prevent
we can't do it.
You know, kids. From
yeah, but
getting
if the first one isn't full, do we know that the first one is full? That's I think
you
that's
can't
the question
because
they're entitled.
They're entitled, so they could be on the bus.
Right, they could be on the bus. So you have to. You have to pretend
have to
you have
a
seat for them.
Yeah.
And
yes.
that's
full disclosure, I was always one of those parents, I will say it, that always every year got my bus pass for my 3 children and they did not take the bus. This year I did not do that.
Oh, there you go.
Thank you.
No, it was just because there would be times that I'm like, well, what if I'm not around
I know,
and I don't.
That's what a lot of people do.
Right. And I live far away from the school and there's not many people that live in my section of town.
If someone has a right to get a bus pass, so. Then you want to get them a bus pass.
But I didn't do it this year.
They might need a bus pass.
Guilt was getting to me.
But the problem is, like, we have to plan on, and you know, the bus company does do counts for us, like,
they'll do counts the first couple weeks, you know, where they'll like keep track of like how many riders there are.
Right.
And then, you know, usually between sports seasons, you see some deviation there too. Oh,
sure.
You know, all of a sudden, you know, you're not playing winter sports, so now you are on the bus.
School, so, I think, but the, you know, you ride the bus in the morning, but now you're in band one day a week, so you don't ride the bus that morning.
That's right.
Or you have an after-school program, or you're in enrichment.
Yeah, that made a difference when we did the after-school program.
All those different things impact who's riding the bus when.
Right.
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 But the double bus run, you know, the kids taking the later bus, they don't take it just because they want to. They take it because the first bus goes off on a route that's not theirs.
Right.
So they have no choice.
And they don't
have a
parent.
Then that bus has to come back and then pick
them
up. So it doesn't matter how full the first bus is, really. The first bus has to take that route. And the child
but I guess
can't
what I'm saying is I bet
go to their house.
Yeah, no, I get that.
Or their stop.
I bet on any given day, though, there's five or six kids that aren't on every bus.
Oh, yeah.
Whether it's an after school, well, it probably is, but
I
sport, an activity,
yeah.
a doctor's appointment, early release, that's what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
So if
right.
you sort of knew that,
yeah, the
then you'd add
the
run back in, mm-hmm. and you could accommodate five or six more children.
Right. That's what I'm telling you.
On
buses
every bus.
Are not full.
That's all
this,
I'm saying.
The buses are not
but
full.
That, but right. we talked about, and this is where I feel like we need to fight for the additional buses, is one of the reasons that the buses are not full is because the
it's
runs are so early or they're late. So
mm-hmm.
before school, there's no point in getting an elementary school student to school half an hour before school begins.
Oh, it's more
unless
than that.
They're going
it's 45
to
45 minutes to an hour.
Yeah, right.
Like 5 of 8,
so,
I remember. Mm-hmm.
So particularly, as a parent, what I've seen is time. School impinges so much on family time these days. School, extracurricular activities that you put your kids in.
Homework.
And kids are tired. Yes, homework is also. All of these things impinge. So am I going to wake my child up an hour earlier to get to school 45 minutes early
part of our
to sit there
our family
so that at the end of the day she's so even, you know, more tired and wasted than she would be? Or am I just going to drive her to school and get her to school 5 minutes before she has to be there as opposed to 45 minutes? And that's the discussion. How do we change? I think if the bus timing could be changed so that it was more reasonable, so that kids were getting to school
at a reasonable amount of time
before school begins, then you would see, I strongly believe you would see more students riding the bus.
We could even talk about later start times for schools.
Yes, we could.
In middle and high school, absolutely, I think.
Well, maybe you add one bus. The proposal is to add one bus initially and kind of monitor behaviors and see what happens.
Yeah, I think we have to. I think the question
I'd
you
like
raised is a good one in the sense: is six
yeah,
buses
if it
enough to eliminate?
Right. If it doesn't eliminate it,
it's
not.
Eliminate it, but if it does, then I totally
agree.
It's
hard
to
predict because, again, as we're talking about, we don't know how many kids are going to ride the bus.
Right.
I mean, we know how many kids are eligible every year because Barry has this program Transfinder. So you know he pinpoints and literally there's a circle and anybody in those areas of town, and including the safety zones that have been identified, those are the people who get sent a bus letter. You know, and there's a lot more
safety
letters.
Zones? What is that? What do you mean?
Well, years ago when we were dealing with the buses, there were some streets that the police and the transportation people and our people worked on to try to identify were there streets that met a certain set of criteria that would determine them to be.
Oh, like no sidewalks?
That was one of them. That was one of them. And then those were the safety zones. So mm-hmm. so not only were you, you know, within the mile and a half, but then there were some streets that were safety zones, which might be actually a little bit, closer than one and a half, maybe. But I know that there have been people for years that have said, I would gladly pay for a bus because I, you know, it's really important to me to get my student, you know, to school safely, and I have to work, and so, and we do run before school programs, you know, now. I mean, we offer a lot more opportunities for families than we used to offer, and including the enrichment enhancement and
so
the great band program and all the things
we
that
could
we
try
do.
To do that quick survey. I don't know if it's possible to do a real quick survey, but to see if
like
individuals that lived sort of outside of the zone would be willing to pay. Just to get a sense of it.
Yeah.
Well, we basically need that more information about what's going to eliminate the double bus
bus run.
Yep, I got that.
Because it's really about providing reasonable opportunity. Buses,
and I can talk, we can talk to Barry. I can talk to Barry.
Transport at reasonable times to students who should have the opportunity.
You know, I mean, because I really respect his opinion, I do want to share with you just quickly Mike's concern about the maintenance position. And if you recall, as I explained last time, you know, it's not that we don't feel we need the maintenance position, it's that in order to hit this number, we were sort of looking at it like, we know we're going to need it the following year, but, you know, because the fields aren't coming online until the summer, you know, perhaps our maintenance crew could do the initial work this year, and then obviously somebody would transition.
And plus what you were saying about maybe sharing a maintenance department with the town.
Yes, possibly. Yes. So he basically just said, you know, he understands that there's a lot of pressure to maintain and keep the new building looking great, and that's we all accept the fact that that's huge. He said he wanted to give me some information as to why he feels we would need to make our case for a new maintenance position for this year. He said, for starters, the two baseball fields, the septic area, which is going to be a pony soccer field, and the two big hills will all be hydro-seeded in the early spring. This means we have grass that will have grass that needs to be cut in July or August, and then throughout the fall. When they say the fields won't be online until next year, that means they can't be played on for the first year. That's true. They will still need to be cut, fertilized, weed whacked, and the other two baseball fields will need to be hand watered. He also feels strongly that there's a lot of automated programs that need to be monitored and maintained on a regular basis. For example, the gray water system has weekly, monthly, quarterly, and annual preventative maintenance requirements. There are solar panels that will have routine maintenance 2 to 3 times a year. There's also 7 good-sized rooftop HVAC units that will need quarterly and annual preventative maintenance. All of the classroom heating is on an automated system that will need to be regulated and monitored on a regular basis. There are several new systems that are going to need regular preventative maintenance not covered by the warranty. And then he said, here's the list he received from DRA, which is our architect firm. Food service equipment, gray water system, plumbing system, building automation system hardware, fluid treatment and chemical cleaning, vertical tube condensing, all this construction talk, stainless steel boilers, main switchboard, fire alarm system, IPTV and video on demand system, public address and intercom system, local sound systems, classroom sound systems, clock and program control, intrusion detection and access controls, video surveillance system. Mm. So he just wanted us to be aware,
sure.
You know, of what his worries are.
When you don't maintain these things according to the plan, you lose the warranty, and then they break down. And
we do
have two
district maintenance people, and obviously we have Mike. But Mike's concern is that, you know, that being that this is a new system, new program, or new building we're going in, he really would love to see whoever's going to be the maintenance person, like, hit the ground running, sure, and get all the training. You know, be ready to go.
So Carol, so you said that's a $40,000.
Yeah, about $40,000. Yeah.
And if you put that into this budget this year,
yeah,
what does that do to the budget request in terms of percentage? Do we add 40,000 to the 13,912?
I'm just getting to my page. Should have brought my computer.
You've already done that, I'm sure, right?
Well, we were discussing today what is the amount of money, the difference between 0.246 and, or 2.46 and
2.5. Yeah.
It's not much money, but let's see. Total worker calculation. We even talked about adding a halftime person.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. A halftime worker.
Yeah, right, halftime maintenance worker, right.
We also discussed going to the town for this.
That's right. That's right.
Instead of
the directions we had were 2.5% or less.
I understand.
But they, and you know, anything that wasn't in the budget already, we had to be prepared to defend. That's not talking about the HVAC system person we were hoping, you know, to get as part of our discussions with the town around the centralized maintenance. But, you know, I think even everybody working on that committee feels like, you know, it's really going to be tough to get all those, you know, all three things right now in this tough economy. But, you know, as Mike said, and he's concerned, he wants to make sure it's well maintained. What'd you find out?
2.75% instead of the 2.46.
2.7.
What happened? Just for kicks. What happens if it's a halftime person?
Halftime.
Sorry.
That's all right.
Just checking all the
halftime worker.
Just wondering.
I mean, I think there's so many things that you would want to see, but it does seem to me that one of the places where I think the bus issue deserves further investigation. And my concern about the buses, I'm not sure, is due to the double bus run, that the issue of the buses arriving too early. I'm not sure how the timing on the buses is determined. And if the bus that goes by my house were to leave, you know, stop at my house a half hour later than
it's a 45-minute run. So that's what they figure. So they drop the students off at the middle high school. They have a few minutes in between. Then they
start.
Like the other day, I was sitting in my office. Kids get out at 2:45. I heard the bus pull up for the second run at just after 3:30.
No, I understand.
So
but
then
I'm
they had to drop the kids off. So they're probably home by 4.
I feel like
that's a 45-minute run. That's all I'm trying to convey to you.
Okay. So that issue, I think, probably warrants some additional investigation, and I'm not sure what that looks like. But to me, the issue of the maintenance of the new school, when this town has made such a significant investment, I don't know, I think it's worth asking for in this budget. And justifying it by saying, you know, we're making these cuts, we're making so that the 38,000 that you cut, that you came up with, I think shows a really good faith effort on the part of the school administration to reduce the budget to stay within this 2.5%. But this town voted and spent this year, you know, all this time and energy to put together this new building that is going to require additional maintenance and to bring on these fields and everything. I mean, I feel like so much of what was done was in response to what we heard the town wanted. So to say we're not going to maintain it?
Well, that's not what we're saying.
I understand.
We need to be clear on that. We're not saying that. You know, we're saying it would be tight using our existing staff, because we do have two townwide town and school district maintenance people, and we now have the turf field, which is going to be less maintenance for them. So, you know, there's definitely some shift in time. Do we think that if there was not an issue that we would absolutely add a full-time maintenance person? Of course we would. We said that from the beginning. You know, obviously when we were picking and choosing the things that, you know, the decisions we waited. And then that's when we thought, well, it's not going to be as needed, you know, in the next year, but we do need the following year. Mike is just, you know, making a case that we maybe weren't aware of when we were initially doing that.
Then maybe you do go
with the halftime, just curious.
The part-time then. So you can look at the situation and see what you actually need, and then you move that position maybe to a full-time the following year.
Yeah, she was just, Joan was just saying it's 2.61%
increase if you add the half.
2.6 instead of 2.47? 2.61?
Yeah, 2.47.
If you add a half time, if we added a half time.
I think you're better off personally going in with what they asked for and just asking for the extra money for maintenance first, and then if we feel prepared, the bus situation. I don't know if there was anything else that surfaced other than maintenance and buses that was, you know, in like the top five ask or wish list.
So you're saying your buses are more...
I think they should be the second ask. I think the custodian, the maintenance custodian.
Is first?
I think so.
Yeah, I think so too.
Are you saying you would like to change the, would you like to add it though, or are you saying present it as the superintendent has presented and then ask the town to?
For the additional money, yes.
Okay.
I think you submit whatever the 2.4, you make the changes that you outlined tonight with the
38.
Yeah. You make those changes and outline all those, can obviously continue to outline those changes in the cover letter.
Mm-hmm.
And then ask for half a maintenance for this year. And then if we can get more information to defend the buses, I'd ask for that as well. But sort of second on the list.
Yeah, I see that.
I mean, that would be my recommendation. I don't know that.
Yeah, I think, I mean, to me it's like six of one half to, I don't, you know, it's a strategy thing and I don't know.
That
what,
is, it's a strategy.
I really don't know what the good strategy is to hit the to hit them with a high number and let them say, no, you're only getting 2.5, or to go in with the low number and say,
mm-hmm.
but this is what this budget doesn't include, and if there's any way you could give us this amount of dollars more, this is what we would do with it.
My concern is if you put it in, then they're going to look to you to look at the overall budget again on then what else you can cut. And to me, you're going too deep now. And then you're going to be in a position where you
yeah.
are cutting services. So that's why
or
I don't think you should.
Cutting programs somewhere. Yeah,
right,
cutting
right,
programs, which
right.
I would really hate.
Yeah,
teachers,
I mean, programs. I mean, we're assuming right now they're going to stick with giving us the 2.46.
Well, right.
Yeah.
I mean, that I wouldn't say that's a slam dunk.
Right.
I mean, I think we're going to make the case as best we can, but I don't know that it's a slam dunk.
Right. But if you put it in, I think they'll make you look at the overall budget, and that
yeah.
doesn't feel appropriate to
I
based on what you've already cut.
Mm-hmm.
That seems sound to me. Good. Yeah.
I agree. I mean, they can, you know, look at it all, and they can say no, but at least we will have put forth the case. And yes, we've invested so much in I mean, this beautiful, beautiful new school. We want to learn how to take care of it from the start and be sure that we're doing it to the best of our ability.
Mm-hmm.
And the fields,
yeah.
which
I mean,
is very important to, you know.
I mean, we're always very good at
explaining this community.
Yeah.
to the FinCom
yeah.
and to the Board of Selectmen everything that's in our budget.
Yes.
I mean, down to the, here's mm-hmm. the line item and here's what it reflects. So, you know, that's all good. But at the end of the day, the FinCom's job is to give you a bottom line.
I understand.
You get to put in it whatever you want.
I understand.
So if they were to say, look, we're going to give you, you know, based on your suggestion, we're going to give you a 2.61% increase, right?
Okay,
then
there you go.
You can put in whatever you want. But obviously it would be disingenuous to argue for that amount of money and not put the maintenance guy in. But at the end of the day, it's like last year we talked about the, you know, the tech guy. I mean, technically, you could have decided to just put the tech guy in, right? Even the FinCom said this is your bottom line. You would have had to cut something else, right? But you could have put the tech. What goes into your budget is really your decision.
Right.
We just think in the best interest of everybody, including everybody in the town, that we should be transparent
absolutely.
About what we put in and why we need it. And
absolutely.
You know, so I think it's the right. I think it's the right way to go. Okay, so that's what you'd like us to do then, and is go with the 2.46% and then have some kind of documentation that basically, you know, says, because this is now going to be your approved budget.
So
right?
when you do this with the 2.46 as it is here, you're going to add under reductions these three things that you discussed
that's
with
correct.
Us.
That's correct.
Those will be added.
That's
yes.
right. Those will be added in the
mm-hmm.
in the amount, and
rest
then and then
yeah.
You know, we can discuss you know, we can maybe create in this document, because it becomes your budget, right? Not it's no longer my budget. So we, you know, in front of my letter, maybe there does want to be something from the school committee, which I can work with you on, Barbie,
mm-hmm.
That just basically, you know, basically states your case.
that after discussing and deliberating, you know, there are priorities that, you know, we're going with we've chosen to present a 2.46, but this doesn't represent, you know, some of the needs that we have, and you just will articulate, you know, what we would need, and then we'll put our rationale down, and that way you can, you know, bring that into the discussion with them. Mm-hmm. So, and you know,
and that would be on the 11th.
That would be on the 11th. We're just waiting for a time on that.
Yeah. Okay.
So we can do that, and that way, mm-hmm. you know, we can reflect this conversation, and we'll change the cover, make it be the school committee's recommended budget, and go forward with that.
Okay, I feel comfortable with that.
Mm-hmm. I feel comfortable with that.
Yes.
All right. Wonderful.
We have the domestic violence policy.
Yes, you have a distribution. But under new business, Barbie, could
yes.
I just speak for 1 minute about that donation that, I mean, that project that the mom, this is, oh gosh, Sarah.
Oh, Natoli?
Yeah.
Yes.
She sent me a really nice email, and well, you can probably remember most
I can,
of it, too.
Yes, I can bring it. Do you want me to bring up the email?
I think you should. Well, here, I have a letter here from her. This Farah Natoli, a mom, whose child went to the French church, and she has this just wonderful, like, just wonderful about her daughter's experience. And
Her own experience.
And her own experience, because she actually was, she was raised overseas. And, you know, she discusses her own personal, you know, journey. And then she's really wanting to raise her teenagers to be very open and enthusiastic about different cultures and, you know, opinions, attitudes, all of that. So she was very supportive of the French trip. But she was so supportive of it that she said, I really want to see these trips continue. So she wants to make $1,000 donation toward an overseas trip.
And it sounded like it wasn't going to be a one-time, but whatever she could afford.
Yeah, she was trying to encourage other people. So we would put it into a public school donation account. But we actually Margie was going to invite Mrs. Natoli to come to the school committee meeting so she could make the presentation herself.
Oh,
but
so
I just think it was such a nice, just the letter, just feeling, you know, her passion for, you know, what she wants for her daughter. And she's just, you know, very great. She first wanted to thank us for making sure the trip could take place. But, you know, she wants to sort of establish this. So what we would do is create in our public school donation account, we'd create a revolving account that would be for overseas trips or something. And then anybody who wanted to make a donation whenever or whatever, we just donate, put it in there. And she wanted it to sort of offset the cost for kids that might not be able to afford it. But
right.
But anyway, we really nice to have
it was
her
very
come.
Nice
and,
of her.
You know, and she, and, but anyway, I wanted to just recognize her for that because I was,
very
I mean, it was
nice.
Very, it was very touching.
Yeah,
and
it was nice.
And very generous.
So I'll see if she's able to.
Yeah, that would be great.
To come in March. Actually, the email back to Carol was, you know, well, I don't have to come, but if you want me to, or you can say it. I think it would be nice if she
I
did have the time.
Nice.
If she
actually
wants
meet
to come,
her, you know,
sure. I don't want to put her on the spot, but you know, she, I mean, it's nice for her to have an opportunity to get recognized for such a generous donation as well.
We always have such generous,
unbelievable in this
people,
town.
Whether it's anonymous or whether it's,
mm-hmm.
you know, it just seems like every meeting we have. Somebody bringing
right.
something, which is very,
and also just
very
allow
nice.
Her to share her passion for international student travel and exchange
mm-hmm.
and
right.
the benefits and how you know.
But you know, the world is changing as we, you know, we were sort of seesawing on the whole French thing. I'm so glad we were able to figure out a way to do it because it does sound like the
and our students
great.
Safe.
Yeah, it does sound like the kids had an amazing time,
that's
and
awesome.
I got a note from. Madame Hayes, and she was just, again, so appreciative that, you know, everybody worked together and
that's awesome.
The kids
oh,
had a great
good.
Time.
Oh, good.
And that, I mean, they're in France, but it's not a vacation for the teachers. I mean, when you're responsible
oh, no.
for somebody else's,
oh, yeah, no,
you know, students
right.
in a faraway country, you know,
It's I did see some amazing pictures from that trip, and it looks like they had a fabulous
time. I think in her initial email to me, she said she has a friend or somebody who a contact in Spain, and if there was a group from the school that wanted to go to Spain, she would make a connection for them. So
I have contacts in Kazakhstan if we ever want
to. And that's right. Yeah, can I? That's right. Go to Kazakhstan. Absolutely.
Growing numbers of contacts.
Absolutely.
Amazing.
Okay. So I think that is it for. Do we want to go over subcommittee reports?
Unless you have anybody who's got a subcommittee, I don't know. I mean, Pam, we had a very brief meeting, but there really wasn't a lot of.
School building? Yeah, it was tiny.
School building. See, this is what I mean when I say I had it here.
I know, I had the same problem.
Gotta be here. Okay.
Only a couple.
Got it. Okay. So we had a school building committee on February 24th, and for the Georgetown Middle High School, the committee approved the use and purchase of Yale brand mechanical locks hardware. Very important.
Okay.
It is. Which are compatible with what we currently use, and Mike Anderson has approved of that. The Pembroke meeting was then held, and the committee agreed to move forward the furniture, fixtures, and equipment, otherwise known as FF&E, awards have been made, and the plan is we're perfectly on track to spend exactly what we were supposed to spend, which is $1,200 per student, as mandated by the MSBA. That will go forward. And we also approved a plan to further explore the idea of building a shed on a larger slab than we had previously talked about. And that could require an engineer or a foundation, some kind of foundation that we might not have needed to use before. Right, it's turned from a shed to a garage. But Mike Anderson believes we need more room to store the equipment to care for our field and our parking lots too. There's going to be snow removal equipment in there, and he's very certain that we're going to need all of that space. So we're going
to
explore.
I asked Mike to make a list of the things that would get stored in there, and when he made the list, there was really little disagreement that that was needed.
Yeah.
That's why I said to him, make the list, Mike, because.
Someone asked.
It's hard to quantify it otherwise, and he did a great job.
Right.
Did you mention at the Georgetown, the middle high school project in the gym, about the banners, the woodwork that people had noticed was.
This
down.
Is the first meeting I went there that I have not mentioned it, but Peter was not there, and. No, they didn't
discuss
we've
it was just
it
where the banners
times.
Are now. There's like wooden slats that are just hanging down.
But
like in that one slot.
It just needs to be I think glued or something just to make it look nice.
I mean?
But
so
during the basketball games,
I
can't believe how many parents mentioned it. They're like, why wouldn't somebody go up there and fix that? I'm like, you're kind of right.
They should just go and fix it.
Yeah, I have
just for the duration
before, and we have brought that up. And
well, I actually think
I believe it's all going to be taken down.
It is going to be taken down,
but
still,
in March,
but
still,
I don't think it would take.
It doesn't look.
It
doesn't
look
great. I agree with you.
Okay, thank you for
that. At least no one got injured by it.
No.
It didn't look.
No, it wasn't teetering. It wasn't unsafe.
Okay, so the agenda, I think, is good. So the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn at 9:29 p.m., but we do require an executive session. We will not be returning, so we will go into executive session, Chapter 30A, Section 21, to discuss personnel issues. And I need a roll call vote to adjourn.
Aye.
Yes. Aye.
Aye.
Great. Thank you. Good night.